Let's pray. Father, you are the strength of our heart and our portion forever. So, Lord, show us this morning as we open your word, just part of that great portion that you have for us. In Jesus' name, amen. If you turn now in your Bibles to Ruth chapter 2, Ruth chapter 2 and verse, we're going to be look again here at these wonderful characters that we have, that God has preserved for us so that we can benefit from their lives and what they learned about God. So let's, Ruth chapter 2 and verse 4. Okay. And behold, Boaz came from Bethlehem and said unto the reapers, the Lord be with you. And they answered, the Lord bless thee. Then said Boaz unto his servant that was set over the reapers, whose damsel is this? And the servant that was set over the reapers answered and said, it is the Moabitish damsel that came back with Naomi out of the country of Moab. And she said, I pray you, let me glean and gather after the reapers among the sheaves. So she came and hath continued even from the morning until now that she tarried a little in the house. Then said Boaz unto Ruth, hearest thou not my daughter? Go not to glean in another field, neither go from hence, but abide here fast by my maidens. Let thine eyes be on the field that they do reap, and go thou after them. Have not I charged the young men that they shall not touch thee? And when thou art athirst, go unto the vessels and drink of that which the young men have drawn. Then she fell on her face, bowed herself to the ground, and said unto him, why have I found grace in thine eyes that thou shouldst take knowledge of me, seeing I am a stranger? Boaz answered and said unto her, it hath been fully showed me all that thou hast done unto thy mother-in-law since the death of thine husband, and thou how thou hast left thy father and thy mother in the land of thy nativity, and art come unto a people which thou knewest not heretofore. The Lord recompense thy work, and a full reward be given thee of the Lord God of Israel, under whose wings thou art come to trust. Now, in our last study, you remember when we're going and we're looking here at Ruth, we saw that how this time here when Boaz comes and he addresses Ruth with the most comforting words that Ruth could ever have heard in her situation. When it says in verse 8, then said Boaz unto Ruth, hearest thou not my daughter? Go not to glean another's field, go from hence and abide here fast by my maidens. When we look at this scene in verse 8 of Ruth in Israel, we've just got to remember, this is a Ruth who is in Israel as a Moabite woman. And she's trying to find food. And what we see here in Ruth is she's in the most vulnerable situation of being among the Jewish people, being a foreigner, not just any foreigner, but a Moabite, which makes her an enemy of the Jewish people. And when we look at this scene in verse 8, we see Ruth in Israel, a Moabite woman, out alone, trying to find food, and finding that she is being despised and rejected of men. There in verse 8, when we see Ruth here in Israel as a Moabite woman out there all alone trying to find food, instead of finding food, she finds herself as a woman of sorrows and acquainted with grief. She just lost her husband. She'd gone through the grief of losing her husband. And there she is in Israel as a Moabite woman out alone trying to find food. And what she sees people doing to her and hiding, as it were, their faces from her, pretending she doesn't exist. And so in verse 8, with Ruth there in Israel as this Moabite woman out there all alone trying to find food for herself, she's just understanding what it will be like for the Lord Jesus Christ, who's described with these very words in Isaiah 53:3. The Lord Jesus, despised, rejected of men, a man of sorrows, acquainted with grief, and we hid, as it were, our faces from him. So when it was time for Ruth to speak with the landowner here, here comes Boaz, very important person. I mean, Boaz, she thought, he's got every reason to reject me. She's got every reason to fear the worst. Instead, Boaz meets Ruth with the most comforting words that she's ever heard. Instead of hearing from Boaz that, look, I despise you, I reject you, and instead of hearing that, she hears verse 8. Then said Boaz unto Ruth, hearest thou not my daughter? I mean, instead of hearing she's despised, she's rejected, he calls her my daughter. See, Ruth is expecting to hear words like, "You horrible Moabite, get off my land." That's what she was expecting. And she's bracing herself to hear from Boaz, but that what she's been feeling from all the other people since she's been around there. But instead of hearing those words of being despised and rejected, she can't believe her ears when she hears him call her daughter, his daughter, my daughter. I mean, Boaz could see in Ruth's face how she was expecting to be despised, rejected. He says, my daughter. I mean, therefore, with these three words, Boaz really puts an emphasis on the my daughter when he says, hearest thou not? You know, those three words, just before, my daughter, hearest thou not, my daughter? In other words, what Boaz is saying, hearest thou not? You know, Boaz was saying to Ruth, Ruth, are you listening? Are you listening to what I'm saying? Because I'm calling you my daughter. Did you hear that? I'm calling you my daughter. Are you hearing it, Ruth? Are you hearing it when I call you my daughter? She's so surprised to hear Boaz call my daughter. Totally unexpected for Ruth. We look at the scene here in verse 8. Ruth in Israel there, the Moabite woman, she's out alone, she's very vulnerable, trying to find food. And instead she finds the most comforting welcome of Boaz. And we see ourselves in Ruth. We look at this and we see, I identify with Ruth. Color me Ruth. That's me in that picture. Because we know from our own experience what it's like to be separated from God by our own sins. Exactly like it says in Isaiah 59:2, where it says, your iniquities have separated between you and your God. Your sins have hid his face from you, and he will not hear. That's all because of us. It was our sins. It was our iniquities that did that separation. And we know from our own experience what it's like to be separated from God. We know from our own experience what it's like to feel defiled, what it's like to feel stained with sin. And we remember when we were the outcast, like Ruth the Moabite in Israel, we were the outcast from God. We remember very clearly our personal BC days. We remember our before Christ days. Before Christ days. And we should never forget those days. Should never forget those days. Paul says, don't you forget those. He emphasizes that in Ephesians 2:11 through 12. In Ephesians 2:11, he starts off by saying, wherefore, remember. He wants us to remember. Remember that ye, being in time past Gentiles in the flesh, who are called the uncircumcision by that which is called circumcision of the flesh made by hands, that at that time you were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers from the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. See, we're told, remember those days. Remember our own personal, what the Bible calls in this passage here, time past, Gentiles in the flesh, time past. There, and then Paul goes through a specific list. He takes the trouble. He doesn't just sort of broad brush says, oh, you remember where you were. No, he says, I want you, when you remember that, you remember specific things about your before Christ days. And in time past. In the time past, you were. And then he starts off. He says, you remember first and foremost how you were without Christ. That's the first thing he calls us to remember on. You were without Christ. Those were days when we were 100% on our own. Those were days when we would never say, God is the strength of my heart and my portion forever. Those are days when we would say, I'm the strength of my heart and I'm my portion forever. Those were days when we were without Christ. Without Christ. Without Christ for what? Without Christ to save us from our sins. Those were days when we were without Christ to save us from our sins. Those were days when we were without Christ to make us a child of God. Nobody is born a Christian. Nobody is born a child of God. Each one of us went through the days without Christ when we were not a child of God. without Christ to make us a child of God, without Christ to guide us through life. We were our only guide, playing dodge the bullet game. But those were days when we were without Christ to guide us. Those were days when we were without Christ to save us from our sins, to save us from our own inclinations, to save us from our own desires, to save us from our own bents of what we wanted to do. Those were days when we were without Christ, who prepared for us a mansion in the Father's house. We didn't have a place of expectation. It was like, death was like, well, I hope. Well, all I can do is hope. A vague, ethereal hope. No, those were days when we were without Christ, without the knowledge that he was preparing a mansion for us in the Father's house. Those were days when we were without Christ to bring us safely to heaven. Or as Johnny Cashfoot said, to not have to cross Jordan alone. Those were terrible days. Those were terrible days when we were without Christ. And only as we remember those days will we be prepared to help the lost around us who are now without Christ. It's only as we remember those we'll be able to take those little invitation to attend the chapel place and not just say, look, this is an invitation for you to come to this strange-looking building here on Mission Gorge Road. It's not that. But this is an opportunity. But with compassion to reach out and say, it's important you come. Because those were days when we remember we were without Christ. And then we are to remember when we were like Ruth, the Moabite alien in Israel. She was a Moabite alien in Israel. And we were aliens from the commonwealth of Israel. And that's what Paul says. You remember, don't you ever forget how you were aliens from the commonwealth of Israel. Commonwealth of Israel. Those were the days when we knew that if we went into a church, we would feel like an alien from outer space, so out of it from the commonwealth of the church. When the church sings these hymns, we'd feel like an alien, so out of place. I got to get away from this place. This is a strange place. I don't know what they're doing. I don't know what they're singing. That's not my place. A commonwealth of the church, the hymns. When the church would read the Bible, we'd feel like an alien, so out of place. The Bible, the commonwealth of the church. When we listen to Bible exposition or sermons or strange people like me, and they feel like an alien. What am I doing there? Listening to that commonwealth of the church. Those were terrible days for us. Those were terrible days for us when we were aliens from the commonwealth of Israel. And only as we remember those days, consciously remember those days, are we going to be prepared to help the lost around us who are now aliens from the commonwealth of Israel. We're to remember, third, we're to remember when we were like Ruth, the Moabite foreigner in Israel, when we were strangers to the covenants of promise. Strangers to the covenants of promise. Those were our days when we had no idea. What are you talking about? What is a person talking about when they talk about the promise of justification by faith? What is that? We were strangers to the promise of justification by faith. That promise. Those were our days when we had no idea when anybody would be talking about cleansing by the blood of Christ. As Gene said, how can red blood make something clean? Right? It's cleansing by, we were strangers to the promise of the cleansing by the blood of Christ. Those were our days when we had no idea what it meant, the promise of salvation by God's grace alone, through our faith alone. I have no idea what you're talking about. See, those were our days. We were strangers to the promise of salvation by grace through faith. Those were terrible days for us. Those were days of darkness. Those were days when we were strangers from the covenants of promise. Only as we remember those days will we be prepared to help those around us who are right now strangers from the covenants of promise. See, that was the third. Number four, we're to remember the days when we were described as having no hope. Having no hope. We're to remember those days. We're to remember those days when we had no hope. We are to remember the days when the best hope that we had was annihilation after death. It's all over. Or as my grandfather, the rabbi, said, when you're dead, you're dead. He was dying, and it was in Petersburg, Virginia. And so there was a man, the Jewish man there. He started the only synagogue, which is still there today. And he was friends with the clergy in the city. And so he was dying on his bed there at home. And there was a knock at the door. They went to the door, and they said, "Who is it?" He said, "It's the Catholic priest." And everybody, the Jews there, "The Catholic priest? Is there no end to the persecution? Has it never stopped?" Yeah. What does he want? He says, "Well, he wants to come and sprinkle you with holy water. You know, give you last rites. Give you last rites." Everybody's in further shock. This is the Inquisition still going on. And so so they all look to my grandfather in the bed there, say, "Well, you know, obviously tell him to leave." And my grandfather said, "Let him come in and do it." And everybody's in shock. All the Jewish men there, "You've been leading and teaching us all this time in Judaism. Why?" They just looked at him. "Why?" And he turned to over him and he said, "Because when you're dead, you're dead." That's the best hope that the lost have, and that's no hope, having no hope. The best hope is annihilation after death. And we're to remember when we hopelessly clung to the belief, because it's a belief system, the belief in evolution that teaches us that not only was there no God involved in our origin, there was no creation, but there's no God involved in our destiny. There is no judgment. There is no creation. There is no judgment. There's no God in how we started. There's no God that we're going to stand before when it's all finished. We are to remember when our greatest hope was our religion called the hide me religion. The hide me religion, where we hoped that death would just hide us from God's judgment. The hide me religion is so clearly seen in Revelation 6:16. Revelation 6:16, where it says, where they said to the mountains and rocks, "Fall on us and hide us from the face of him that sitteth on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb." That's the hide me religion. The hide me religion is to look at mountains and rocks and pray those words of Revelation 6:16 to the mountains and the rocks for them. "Please fall on me, hide me from the face of him that sits on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb." The hide me religion is to look at the dirt next to a dug grave and pray to the dirt the words of Revelation 6:16 and say, "Fall on me and hide me from the face of him that sits on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb." The evolution belief, which is required for the hide me religion, means to have no hope, having no hope. Those were terrible days for us. Those were terrible days when we were in the state of having no hope. And only as we remember those days are we going to be prepared to help the lost around us who are now having no hope. And we are to remember, Paul goes on further and says, of those days when we were without God in the world. That's scary. Without God in the world, you are on your own. You are without God in the world. It's scary. It's a scary place out there. Yeah, the world is a scary place. And it's no place for a person to be without God. It's a frightening description to be without God in the world. And when we remember, when we were there, we were without God in the world. We were in the world without God to turn to for instruction and for teaching and for guidance in life, as described in Psalm 32:8. You know, we've been talking about God is my portion, the strength of my heart, and my portion forever. That's a promise. That's a wonderful benefit. But other benefits of having God in the world, and there was a time when we were without God in the world, and we didn't have the benefit of Psalm 32:8, where God said, "I will instruct thee and teach thee in the way which thou shalt go, and will guide thee with mine eye," he says. We were in the world without God to turn to for direction in life. Jeremiah said, I know it's not in man. It's not in man to direct his way. Man doesn't have what it takes to direct himself. But there's a great benefit to being with God in the world. And God describes it. It's described for us in Proverbs 3:6. In all thy ways, acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy paths. In all thy ways, all of them, not just a few, all of your ways, acknowledge him, and he will direct thy paths. He'll straighten them out, the word direct. He will straighten your paths. We were without world. We were without God. We were in the world without God to turn to when we needed him to lead us into safety. We're getting into dangerous positions. We need safety. We've been talking about cancer that's coming up and heart failure and all these things failing. It's dangerous. We need God to lead us into safety. As it says in Isaiah 49:10, they shall not hunger nor thirst, neither shall the heat nor sun smite them, for he hath mercy on them, he shall lead them. Even by the springs of water shall guide them. You know what everybody repeats when they're in trouble? They want the hope of 23rd Psalm. They want the 23rd Psalm. But to be in God, to be in the world without God, is to be in the world without God to turn to for the truths of the 23rd Psalm. It's not a mantra, it's a confession. And so in Psalm 23, 1 through 2, leading into safety, the Lord is my shepherd. It's to be in the world without God is to be in the world without God to turn to say and mean and have the reality of the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. In the world without God to turn to for the first three verses of Psalm 23. To be in the world without God is to be in the world without God to turn to for protection. Protection in life. Psalm 91 is a psalm of protection. Oh, the whole psalm from this beginning, and it starts off in the first four verses, sets the tone for protection. He that dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty, under the protection of the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, he's my refuge and my fortress, my God, in him will I trust. Surely he shall deliver thee from the snare of the fowler, which you can't see, and from the noisome pestilence, which you fear. He shall cover thee with his feathers, and under his wings shalt thou trust. His truth shall be thy shield and buckler. See, in the world without God is in the world without God to turn to for protection. In the world without God is in the world without God to turn to for help. Help, as it says in Psalm 121. Just right over that psalm, help. It's all about help, Psalm 121. Starts off, I will lift up mine eyes unto the hills. From whence cometh my help? My help cometh from the Lord, which made heaven and earth. The Lord said on the cross in Psalm 22, help me. He says, be not far from me. It's a prayer for help. To be in the world without God is to not have God to turn to for help. To be in the world without God is to not have God to turn to for the strength of my heart. Is to not have God to turn to for strength. Isaiah 41:10 says, fear thou not, for I am with thee. Be not dismayed, for I am thy God. I will strengthen thee. I will help thee. Yea, I will uphold thee with the right hand of my righteousness. In the world without God to turn to for help. In the world without God to turn to when afraid of death, just dying, afraid of that moment of death, as described in Psalm 23:4. Again, the 23rd Psalm. Yea, though I walk through the valley of death, that's the fear of death, the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff comfort me. In the world without God, who do you turn to in the fear of death, when there's the shadow of death, when there's the fear of dying? In the world without God, that was terrible. In the world without God to turn to for the fear of what happens after death. Okay, maybe there's some morphine around that could get me through it, but what happens afterward? As described again in the 23rd Psalm, verse 6, surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I'll dwell in the house of the Lord forever. In the world without God to turn to for fear of what happens after death, terrible days. In the world without God to turn to for care, just to be cared for, to be cared for. As the Lord said in Psalm 33:18, behold, the eye of the Lord is upon them that fear him, upon them that hope in his mercy. That's care, the eye of the Lord upon them. Psalm 34:7, the angel of the Lord encampeth around about them that fear him and delivereth them. How marvelous to be so cared for, to have the eye of God on you and the angel, his emissaries, the angels being charged. Now you make a camp around him. In the world without God to be cared for in life. In the world without God to turn to as Father. To turn to as Father. As it says in Romans 8:15, for you have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but you have received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father. Such a comforting thing to be adopted when you're an orphan. I told you about Dr. Yolanda Trejo down in Tecate, Mexico, in her orphanage. She has no children of her own, and she adopts kids left and right. She has a lot of kids she's adopted, and it makes them feel so secure. And one time, she has a daughter, and so the little girl was sitting there one evening, and they decided they have to tell her, you know, they had to tell her that she was adopted. So they were all nervous, and they sat down and they started talking to her, and they told her, and she stood there like this, you know, the little girl like that, and they were all nervous as they were trying to explain to her she was adopted. And so she said, so when they did, the little girl said, I thought so. She said, because I'm a lot shorter than you. But it's a comforting thing to be adopted. My friend Rick Hodes, he's never been married, he's in Addis Ababa in Egypt. He's a Jewish doctor there, and he takes care of the kids with cancer, and he has like about 20 kids sleeping on his living room in there, and he's adopted one right after the other. And so I met his mother one time, and one of them, the adopted kids, Semenu, was over here at a medical place. And anyways, she said, yes, and then she says, I only have 5 grandchildren, and they're all black, she said. But it's marvelous to be adopted. It's wonderful to have that comfort. And God says, you, without God to turn to, without God in the world, and without God to turn to for being adopted. For without God, in the world without God, to turn to and be able to call him Father. That's not something you can automatically do. You can't walk up to anybody and call him Father. But we're adopted. In the world, we are to remember those days when we were in the world without God to turn to for forgiveness and healing. Forgiveness and healing. Where do you go for forgiveness? Where do you go for healing? God says in Psalm 103:3, who forgiveth all thine iniquities and healeth all thy diseases. To be in the world, to remember this, we were in the world. There was a time we were in the world. We were without God to turn to for healing a broken heart. Where do you get a broken heart healed? Except in God. And God says in Psalm 147:3, he healeth the broken in heart. He healeth the broken in heart and bindeth up their wounds. We're to remember when we were in the world without God to turn to for peace when we're disturbed, deeply disturbed inside. Where do you find peace? But we were in the world. There was a day we were in the world without God, and we didn't have God to turn to for peace and when we were disturbed. As it says in Numbers 6:26, the Lord lift up his countenance upon thee and give thee peace. That's what God does. Philippians 4:7, the peace of God, which passes understanding, you can't figure it out, which passes understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. We're to remember the days when we were in the world without God to turn to for rest when we're troubled. Where do you go for rest when you're troubled in the soul? As he said in Matthew 11:28 and 29, come unto me, I will give you, all you that labor and are heavy laden, I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you, learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, you shall find rest unto your soul. Where do you turn to without God for rest for the soul? When there was a time when we were in the world, and we're to remember that, we were in the world without God to turn to for loneliness. Loneliness. Where do you turn to without God when you don't have anybody and you feel lonely in your soul? But God says in Psalm 73:23, nevertheless, I am continually with thee. Thou hast holden me by my right hand. In the world, we're to remember when we were in the world without God to turn to for comfort. Without God, there is no comfort. But 2 Corinthians 1:3-4, blessed be God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and the God of all comfort, who comforteth us in all our tribulation. Those were terrible days when we were without God in the world. Without God in the world. In the world without God to turn to for instruction, for teaching, for guidance, for direction in life, for leading in life, for protection in life, for help in life, for strength in life, for when we're afraid of death, when we're afraid of what happens after death, for being cared for in life, for having God as our Father in life, for finding forgiveness and healing for a broken heart, and peace when we're disturbed, and rest when we're troubled, and loneliness and comfort, and we could go on and on with the list. But it's what it means to have none of that, to be in the world without God. And God says, don't you ever forget that. Because only as we remember those days will we be prepared to help the lost who are now without God in the world. But Ruth didn't find from Boaz what she expected. You know, she was expecting to be turned away from Boaz, but instead, Ruth found this wonderful welcome. And when he called her my daughter, we see ourselves surprised when God welcomes us with arms wide open. We remember our days past. We've been talking about. We remember how we came to God saying, I'm not worthy. I'm not worthy, which is the phrase that Jacob used when he came to God in Genesis 32:10. I've been hanging around the Willardson boys too long. I can't get those prophets straight. Sorry. All right, Genesis 32:10. He said, I am not worthy of the least of all the mercies. Forget about the biggest ones, but I'm not even worthy of the least of them. And of all the truth which thou hast showed unto thy servant. This is what the centurion said when he came to the Lord Jesus Christ in Matthew 8:8. It says, the centurion answered and said, Lord, I am not worthy that thou shouldst come under my roof, but speak the word only, my servant will be healed. This is what John the Baptist said. John the Baptist said in John 1:27, he it is who coming after me is preferred before me, whose shoe latchets I am not worthy to unloose. I'm not even worthy to untie his shoes. It's what the prodigal son said when he was rehearsing before he returned to the father, and the words that he did say when he did return to the father in Luke 15:21. It says, and the son said unto him, Father, I've sinned against heaven and in thy sight, and am no more worthy to be called thy son. See, like Ruth, God showed this unexpected grace to, when Boaz called her my daughter, we have been shown unexpected grace. When it says, as we said in Psalm 103:3, he forgives all thine iniquities, that's grace. In Isaiah 1:18, though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow, though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool, that's grace. John 1:12, as many as received him, to them gave he the power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name, that's grace. See, 1 Peter 1:4, we are coming to an inheritance, incorruptible, undefiled, fadeth not away, reserved in heaven for you, that's grace. John 14:2-3, in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. If I go and prepare a place for you, I'll come again, receive you unto myself. Where I am, there you may be also. That's grace. That's grace. If we suffer, we shall also reign with him. Reign with him. That's grace. Who expects this? Unexpected. And Ruth did not expect what Boaz did for her. And we did not expect what God did for us. And that reminds me, one Sunday I came to the church, it had been a rough week. It was really a rough week. I don't know what it was. It was so rough I forgot. But it was rough. And an elderly Christian woman was standing at the back of the church there to greet me. And I saw her raise her hand to my cheek. And I winced. I was expecting to get slapped across the face. It was that kind of a week. And instead, she gently touched my cheek to comfort me. People don't do that to me. But anyway, she did. That's how God treats us. God treats us that we expect the slap. God gives the pat. Okay? There's one word to describe what Boaz did for Ruth. And that word is the word that Naomi used to describe what Boaz did for Ruth. And you can see it there. You look down at verse 20, Ruth 2:20. And Naomi said unto her daughter-in-law, blessed be he of the Lord who hath not left off his kindness to the living and to the dead. Naomi said unto her, the man is near and kin to us. Okay. Kindness, chesed. Kindness, chesed means mercy, kindness, loving kindness. The picture of this kindness, this chesed kindness, is in Proverbs 17:17, a friend loveth at all times. Brother is born for adversity. See, when we take a look here and we see Boaz showing kindness to Ruth, it reminds us of something. Reminds us of way on back there in the land of Moab, when they were on her turf. In her land, and how Ruth showed kindness to Naomi. Have you ever thought of that famous passage in the first chapter of this book? As a statement of kindness? When it says in Ruth 1:16, and Ruth said, entreat me not to leave thee, or return from following after thee, for whither thou goest I will go, where thou lodgest I will lodge, thy people shall be my people, thy God my God, where thou diest will I die, and there will I be buried. The Lord do so to me, more also if aught but death part thee and me. That's kindness. That was kindness of Ruth to Naomi. When Naomi was the despised foreigner, and when Naomi was the rejected Jewess in Moab, then Ruth showed her kindness when she said those words. She said, I won't leave you, Naomi. I'm going to go with you, Naomi. I'm going to live with you, Naomi. I'm going to be part of your people, Naomi. I'm going to take your God, Naomi. And I'm going to be buried where you're buried, Naomi. Kindness, 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 kindness. That's kindness that Ruth was showing to Naomi. Kindness. That was Ruth showing kindness to Naomi. Boaz knew that. Boaz knew that Ruth had shown that kindness to Naomi. And that became why Boaz showed kindness to Ruth. Because he had seen how Ruth had shown kindness to Naomi. That's what he meant when he said, it's been fully showed me what you did to your mother-in-law. That's illustrating for us a principle that King David described of how God shows mercy It's just like Boaz in Psalm 18:25-26. Psalm 18:25-26. With the merciful, thou wilt show thyself merciful. With an upright man, thou wilt show thyself upright. With a pure, thou wilt show thyself pure. With the froward, thou wilt show thyself froward. With the merciful, Ruth, Boaz showed mercy. That's repeated by the Lord Jesus Christ in the Sermon on the Mountains, Matthew 5:7. Blessed are the merciful, they shall obtain mercy. Ruth was merciful to Naomi. Ruth obtained mercy. Whenever I think about how Ruth showed mercy to Naomi, and then Boaz then in turn showed mercy to Ruth, I think about that time when our family had just arrived by plane in Milan at Linate Airport. And it was in wintertime, and it was, I told you this before, I don't know, it was winter, it was dark, and as the plane was coming down to land there was such a thick fog, I thought, it looks like we're diving into an ocean. Couldn't see anything. The city was hidden under the fog. The city was completely socked in with fog. It was engulfing the city. And we rented a car. And we rented a car there, and we had to find the Jolly Hotel in Milano Due. And I thought I was so clever, I was so proud of myself at how much money we had saved by this rental car, because I didn't even know what it was, but I rented a Fiat 500. And in the 1980s, it's about half the size of the Fiat 500 today. So when they brought the car out, my wife and two boys and I, we stood with all of our luggage in total disbelief. And they brought this car out, and you know, I didn't know how they can make a car so small. And so I said, well, pile in, you know. So they all piled into the car. The boys sat on their luggage in the back seat, you know. There was no other place, you know. And we started off in this complete fog, having no idea where we were and how we were going to find the Jolly Hotel in Milano Due. Because there's another Jolly Hotel in Milan also, you know. You couldn't even see the line on the street. It was that foggy. You know, it was like being on one of those rides in Disneyland, you know, where you kind of go in and it's all dark, and all of a sudden you turn out, things appear, you know. And that's the way it was. And we were surprised every time the headlights would show something. And so I started off driving, and you know, the lights shine. And all of a sudden there's this, it's like I said, it's a Disneyland ride. And so all of a sudden there's this lady, and she's going like this. It reminded me of Disneyland Light. You know, it says, stop. And so she's standing right in front of the car. She's begging us to stop so she could get a ride. She needed to get home already. It's dark, you know, it's foggy. What are you going to do? So, you know, the family, they looked at me, and I said, well, of course, we're going to stop. So we stop, and the lady looks at the little car, and I said, you know, it's all motion with my hand, it's all we got, but get in if you want. And so stopped the car. Family thought I was out of my mind, and I invite the lady in. She climbs on top of the luggage with the boys. The boys are, like, smashed on either side. She was a rather large lady. She sat right in the middle, you know, and there wasn't even room for me to shift the car, you know, because there were legs and all these things in the way. And she spoke Italian, and we didn't. And so, but, you know, we kept getting it, you know, turn right, turn left, you know, this way, that way, you know, and other things that she'd say. And then finally she said, stop. And so we stopped. We reached her house. And I let her out, and she got out of the car. And, you know, then the family looks at me like, well, Christopher Columbus, where are we going to go now, you know? So we got out and says, okay, goodbye. And she with it, she lived right next door to the Jolly Hotel. It was unbelievable. I look up and I thought, it's a miracle. A lot of miracles happen in Italy. So, but the point is that I showed mercy to this old lady, and the Lord showed mercy to me. But when we look at verse 8, where it says, then said Boaz unto Ruth, we can see there how much Boaz condescended to speak to Ruth. As a landowner, Boaz had a very high position, and as a Moabite widow, Ruth had a very low position. But because Boaz condescended to speak to Ruth in verse 8, Ruth gained a very high position, being made an equal to a daughter of Boaz, with privileges of a daughter, the most privileged place among the reapers there to gather, the most privileged place of protection, by having the young man being warned by Boaz himself, treat her respectfully, treat her with dignity, let grain fall to her. The most privileged place of provision, by arranging that the young men are going to draw water for her. She was elevated because of Boaz. She was elevated because Boaz condescended to come to her. It was the condescension of Boaz that made Ruth great. And that's a picture of how we as believers in the Lord Jesus Christ have been elevated. Just like Ruth, we have gained a high position of being made equal to a child of God. And like Ruth, we've been given this high position of the most privileged place of care, as God said, as he said to Israel in Deuteronomy 32:10. He found him in a desert land, waste howling wilderness, led him about, instructed him, kept him as the apple of his eye. We've been given the most privileged place of protection with the ability to say the same words that were said in 2 Samuel 22:2, the Lord's my rock, my fortress, my deliverer, the God of my rock, in him will I trust. He is my shield, the horn of my salvation, my high tower, my refuge, my Savior. Thou savest me from violence. I will call on the Lord, who is worthy to be praised. So shall I be saved from mine enemies. We've been given the most privileged place of provision. Psalm 147:14. He maketh peace in thy borders and filleth thee with the finest of wheat. Deuteronomy 8:7. The Lord thy God bringeth thee into a good land, a land of brooks of water, of fountains, the depths that spring out of the valleys, the hills, a land of wheat, barley, vines, fig trees. I like figs. Fig trees, pomegranates, a land of olive oil, honey, a land wherein thou shalt eat bread without scarceness, thou shalt not lack anything in it, a land whose stones are iron, out of whose hills thou mayest dig brass. Psalm 84:11, the Lord God is a sun and a shield. The Lord will give grace and glory. No good thing will he withhold from them that walk uprightly with him. See, even to the least detail of how long the shoes lasted when those 40 years when they were walking in the desert, it was as if God said, has any of you taken a time to look down at your shoes lately after 40 years? Because it's a question, have you thought about how it's possible to not, ladies, have you thought about how it's possible to not have to buy shoes in 40 years? He says in Deuteronomy 29:5, I have led you 40 years in the wilderness. Your clothes are not waxing old upon you. Your shoe is not waxing old upon thy feet. He says, look at it. And just as the only reason that Ruth was made great was because of Boaz condescended to come down to her, that's the only reason we've been made great. It's because God, in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ, condescended to come to us. As it says in Philippians 2:5, let this mind be in you, which is also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God. Of course not, he was God. But made himself of no reputation, condescension. Took upon him the form of a servant, condescension. Was made in the likeness of men, condescension. Being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself, condescension. And became obedient unto death, condescension. Even the death of the cross, ultimate condescension. Because it's because of the condescension of the Lord, we've been made great. And because of the condescension of Boaz, Ruth was made great. And that's what's described in Psalm 18:35. Thou hast given me the shield of thy salvation. Thy right hand hath holden me up. Thy gentleness hath made me great. Psalm 18:35. See, that verse tells us how we've been made great, having been given the shield of salvation. The Hebrew word for salvation is Yeshua, or Jesus. And that's what Jesus is to us. He's the shield of salvation. He's our shield. The Lord Jesus Christ shields us from the evil. 2 Thessalonians 3:3, the Lord is faithful, who will establish you and keep you from evil, or the evil one. The Lord Jesus Christ prayed for us in John 17:15. I pray not that thou shouldst take them out of the world, but that thou shouldst keep them from the evil. Just the name alone of the Lord Jesus Christ is our shield. As it says in Proverbs 18:10, the name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous runneth into it and is safe. You know, the Hebrew name for shield is Magen. And this is David who wrote this, Psalm 18:35. So David is saying, thou hast given me, David, the shield of thy salvation. Thou hast given me the shield of thy Jesus, of thy Yeshua. See the six-pointed Jewish star? That's called a Magen David. David's shield. And so in Psalm 18:35, when David tells us Yeshua was David's shield, That's David's Magen, or Magen David. Yeshua is the Magen David. See, then in Psalm 18:35, it says, "Thy gentleness hath made me great." The Hebrew word for gentleness is the word anava. Anava, and which comes from anaviv. And we can see the meaning of anaviv when you look at Psalm 147:6, where it says, "The Lord lifteth up the meek." Psalm 147:6. "The Lord lifteth up the meek." The Lord anaviv, the meek. Anaviv. Anaviv, lifted up. It has the meaning of being low, meek. Sorry, meek is anaviv. Anaviv means low, and you get lifted up from a low state. So Psalm 18:35 reads, "Thy anava hath made me great," which means thy low position hath made me great. Or we could say, "Thy condescension has made me great." We've been made great by the condescension of the Lord. Psalm 18:35, "Thy condescension hath made me great." The condescension of Boaz made Ruth great. The condescension of the Lord Jesus Christ has made us great. But there's something else we see about what Boaz said in verse 8 when it's the word "then." Just that word, "then." Just one word, "then." "Then said Boaz unto Ruth." The word "then" brings us to see at that moment. At that moment, Boaz spoke to Ruth. There was Ruth in his field, and there he had just found out about Ruth. And there was that opportunity for Boaz to speak to Ruth. There was the opportunity for Boaz to either speak roughly to Ruth and ask her to leave his field, or to not speak to Ruth and convey the same message to Ruth, and she was not really welcome in the field, and she might as well move on, or to do as he did, to speak as he did kindly to her. That's the word "then." "Then" brings home to us that it's showtime for Boaz. The spotlight's on him. The word "then," God's spotlight was on Boaz. It was the time for Boaz to make a decision and move, speak kindly. This brings us to how our opportunities to show kindness are passing. They're passing. We need to seize our "then" opportunities in our lives. We need to recognize them and seize them. Mordecai saw the "then" opportunity for Esther when he wrote to Esther in Esther 4:14, "If thou altogether holdest thy peace at this time," that's a then "shall their enlargement and deliverance arise to the Jews from another place." Don't you worry your sweet little head about it. God's going to save the Jews. But that's not in the scripture. That's a little anecdote. So, "but thou and thy father's house shall be destroyed. Who knoweth whether thou art come into the kingdom for such a time as this?" That's the "then." When Mordecai wrote those words, "Thou art come into the kingdom for such a time as this," when he wrote that to Esther, Mordecai was telling Esther she had reached her "then" moment in her life, which was the reason why she had been raised to the position of the queen of Persia. By saying to Esther, "Thou art come into the kingdom for such a time as this," Mordecai was telling Esther God had overruled all those other women who were there in the running to become queen of Persia and placed you, Esther, as queen of Persia so that you could seize this then opportunity for you. And if Esther had failed in that critical moment to seize the opportunity, then she would have failed to accomplish the reason for her exaltation. If Esther had failed in that critical moment, then it would have been like a pregnancy that went into miscarriage. The then opportunities, they seem to just suddenly come to us with no advance warning. We find ourselves in this then opportunity. You know, it reminds me of this last week. I was standing in line at a grocery store buying the nectarines and the peaches for the pie I made for family night. If you didn't have some, sorry. And anyway, there was a young woman, and she was in front of me, and she was buying this 10-pound piece of chuck roast and a lot of vegetables. And then there was an older woman in front of her who had already been checked out. And I was wondering, move on, lady. But anyway, she stood there, and she held up the whole line, this older woman, and asking the younger woman, "Are you a cook? What are you going to have? What are you going to cook tonight? Who's coming over to your house for dinner?" And on she was going, you know. And I just want to check out, and I was getting irritated. But I listened, and I finally realized, you know, because I'm like Einstein, I finally realized she's Jewish. So outside the store, I find her, and I said, "So, you like to cook?" "I like to cook. Let's talk." So it turns out she was Jewish. And anyway, I invited her to come to church, to family night. As soon as I said church, she said no. But then she asked, what was the name of the church? And so in the end, she promised to come to the Creation Museum. We exchanged phone numbers. See, that was a then sudden then opportunity. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they're probably sitting there having afternoon tea. They thought, well, this is nice. What could be wrong here? Suddenly, they're arrested and brought before King Nebuchadnezzar and threatened with death that they didn't worship Nebuchadnezzar's gods. That was a sudden then opportunity, a little disruptive. But they said that was their opportunity, declare their allegiance to one God. And they said something very significant when they said to Nebuchadnezzar in Daniel 3:14, Nebuchadnezzar spake and said unto them, is it true, O Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego? Do you not serve my gods, nor worship the golden image which I have set up? Now, if you be ready, at what time you hear the sound of the cornet, flute, the harp, sackbut, the psaltery, and dulcimer, and all kinds of music, and you fall down and worship the image that I've made, well, that's okay. But if you worship not, you'll be cast the same hour into the midst of the burning fiery furnace. Who is that God that shall deliver you out of my hands? Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered. It's interesting what they answered. Because they said, well, you know, they didn't say something like, you know, can you give us a little time to powwow on this? Can we take a break and discuss? You know, we were just having afternoon tea. It's a little sudden, you know, if we could just have a little time just to formulate our words. You know, we need a little time to be careful about what we say. It says, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered and said to the king, O Nebuchadnezzar, we are not careful to answer thee in this thing. They said, we don't need a powwow. We don't need a conference. We don't need to formulate our answer. We'll tell you right now, if it be so, our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, and he will deliver us out of your hand, O king. But if not, be it known unto thee, O king, that we will not serve thy gods, nor worship the golden image which thou hast set up. That was a turning point for that country. That was a turning point for King Nebuchadnezzar, as you know what happened after that. But they said, we're not careful to answer thee in this matter, which means that even though it's in the sudden heat of the moment, they were not going to give it a second thought to give the king a more politically correct answer. They had their then opportunity to stand for God, and they did. And it's recorded for all eternity, and we're just reading about it now. And they were telling the king they would not refrain from speaking that the Lord is God alone, even if it cost them their lives. And David said in Psalm 40, verse 9, I have preached righteousness in the great congregation. Lo, I have not refrained my lips. O Lord, thou knowest. That was them. See, the prophet Amos, he had his then moment or his opportunity that came to him again suddenly. You know, he was out there just minding his business. He wrote about it. He told Amaziah in Amos 7:14, then answered Amos and said to Amaziah, I was no prophet, neither was I a prophet's son. I was a herdman, a gatherer of sycamore fruit. The Lord took me. As I followed the flock, the Lord said unto me, go, prophesy unto my people Israel. Now, therefore, hear the word of the Lord. Thou sayest, prophesy not against Israel, and drop not, etc. See, what Amos was saying is that I wasn't raised to be a prophet. I'm not even the son of a prophet. I had no intention of being a prophet. I was just minding my own business, herding sheep, gathering fruit from the sycamore tree. Well, all of a sudden, God says, the Lord says, Amos says, all of a sudden, he says, the Lord spoke to me. He told me, go prophesy to my people, God's people, Israel. And that was his then moment for Amos. And he says that what he did in his then moment, because he says, now therefore, hear the word of the Lord. See, he went from speaking to sheep to follow him to speaking to Israel to follow him. That was his then opportunity. And and this whole then opportunity is what's emphasized about how the followers of the Lord followed the Lord. How was it that Peter and Andrew and James and John became followers of the Lord? What were the details of that? In Matthew 4:18, Jesus walking by the seaside of Galilee saw two brethren, Simon called Peter, Andrew his brother, casting a net into the sea. They were fishers. He saith unto them, follow me, I'll make you fishers of men. They straightway left their nets and followed him. Going on from thence, he saw two other brethren, James the son of Zebedee, John his brother, in a ship with Zebedee their father, mending their nets. He called them. They immediately left the ship and their father and followed him. You know, Peter, Andrew, James, and John, they're just minding their own business. They're fishermen. You know, the Lord comes and he comes with just one simple offer. He says, a simple offer, and they couldn't refuse it. Follow me, I'll make you fishers of men. You know, that was their then moment. They didn't say, well, let me think about it. You know, their response was not Jonah's response. You know, in Jonah 3:2, arise, he says, go unto Nineveh, that great city, preach unto it the preaching I bid thee. And Jonah says, no, and he goes the opposite direction. But that was not the response of Peter and Andrew, James and John. Their response is straightway, they left their nets and followed him. Immediately left the ship, and their father followed him. And as they did, can't you hear the father saying, where are you going? You know, we're in the middle of mending the nets. What are you doing? Why are you leaving me with all this work to do? See, that's what it means to seize the then moment, which Boaz did when he spoke to Ruth kindly. That's the response that God wants us to have when suddenly we find ourselves in our then moment of opportunity. And sometimes our then moment of opportunity may be an opportunity just to pray, as happened with Hezekiah in 2 Kings 19. 2 Kings 19, when the whole city was threatened, Hezekiah said, this is the day. This day is a day of trouble, rebuke, blasphemy. The children are come to birth. There's no strength to bring forth. Maybe the Lord will hear the words of Rabshakeh, king of Assyria, as reproached the Lord. And then he said, wherefore, lift up thy prayer for the remnant that are left. See, the then moment was an opportunity to pray, which he did. And he saved Israel from destruction. We have then moments to pray, as Paul wrote in Romans 12:12, when he said, rejoicing in hope, patient in tribulation, continuing instant in prayer. Sometimes our then moments are opportunities to respond, as Peter said in 1 Peter 3:15, sanctify the Lord God in your hearts. Be ready always to give an answer to every man that asketh you a reason of the hope that is in you with meekness and fear. Be ready to give an answer to every man, whether or not he asks you. Give the answer. So what we've seen is how Boaz took the then opportunity, and he spoke kindly and in an acceptance and a welcome to Ruth, and he made Ruth great by his condescension to her low position to lift her up. What should we do with this? Resolve to be like Boaz. Look for the then moments to bring the hope of the gospel to the gospel-less. Let's pray. Lord, do help us. Help us, Lord, we pray, to see the then moments that you have for us, to seize them, and to bring hope to the hopeless. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.